But Jonah Christianity defies this. It is not anti-intellectual, but instead informed by a variety of philosophical sources. It is not anti-pagan, but rather sees itself as part of a continuous and unfolding revelation of the divine in the world. The revelation of the divine in history. And the pagan thinkers and creators, mystics and magicians are as much a part of that tradition as the Christian saints.
Alleluia. You're listening to Talks Alleluia. From the Apostolic Johannite Church.
Alleluia. So, welcome everyone. For those of you who don't know me or who are listening to this on our podcast series, The Lectern, I'm Dr. William Behan, otherwise known as Mark Thomas. I'm primate for the United States of America for the Apostolic Johannite Church. I'm really honored today to be giving the first of the Julian Eimer Memorial Lectures. Dr. Eimer was, of course, my late wife, and she began a series of talks at Conclave on some of the female saints, in particular of the Apostolic Johannite Church. And so I thought it particularly fitting to continue that practice today and to take up a particular figure who's really unique in the wonderful panoply of saints that we have in the Apostolic Johannite Church. And that's Hypatia of Alexandria. As far as I can figure out, Hypatia is our only explicitly pagan saint, which is a little peculiar for a Christian church, but I think very much in keeping with the nature of the Apostolic Johannite Church, which embraces truth in whatever form it happens to take. And Hypatia is a wonderful example of that. Hypatia was born probably around 370. Could be as early as 350, dates are a little bit uncertain. The date of her death is pretty well known, it happens in 415. And her death is often sort of used to mark the end of paganism as an intellectual force within the Roman Empire. Not because she was so profound a figure that you know, paganism just sort of curled up and died with her, but rather that she was a symptom, or her death was a symptom of an increasing anti-intellectualism within the Christian Empire. So let's get a couple of descriptions of who she was, or at least one historical account. This one from Socrates of Constantinople, who is a Christian writer. And he writes, "There was a woman at Alexandria named Hypatia, daughter of the philosopher Theon, who made such attainments in literature and science as to far surpass all the philosophers of her own time. Having succeeded to the school of Plato and Plotinus, she explained the principles of philosophy to her auditors, many of whom came from quite a distance to receive her instruction. On account of the self-possession and ease of the manner which she had acquired in consequence of the cultivation of her mind, she not infrequently appeared in public in the presence of the magistrates. Neither did she feel abashed in going to an assembly of men. For all men, on account of her extraordinary dignity and virtue, admired her the more." That's quite a glowing sort of representation of somebody who's ultimately going to find her death at the hand of a Christian mob. Umberto Eco, in his Babilino, gives an interesting representation of Hypatia through the character of, strangely enough, Hypatia, who's not the Hypatia, but she is a Hypatia. It's very confusing. Read the book. But this character is a sort of continuation of Hypatia's school. And she herself, in the book, concedes that we don't actually know anything about Hypatia's works. And this is generally true. Although, Egbert does a very good job building what I think is a thoughtful and plausible set of ideas and practices that might well have been associated with the historical Hypatia of Alexandria. The description that Echo gives tells us a lot about her own particular form of Neoplatonism, and there are considerable Gnostic overtones. Allow me to read from Baudolino. This is how Baudolino describes the historical Hypatia. Hypatia really did exist, even if it was not 1,000 years ago, but rather 8 centuries. And she lived in Alexandria, Egypt, when the empire was ruled by Theodosius and then by Arcadius. She really was, we are told, a woman of great wisdom, learned in philosophy, mathematics, and in astronomy, and even men drank in her every word. In the meantime, our holy religion had triumphed in all the territories of the empire. There were still some unruly people who were trying to keep alive the thought of the pagan philosophers, such as the divine Plato, and I will not deny that they were doing good, transmitting also to us Christians the learning that we would have lost otherwise. But one of the greatest Christians of the time, who later became a saint of the church, Cyril, a man of great faith, but also of great intransigence,
wonderful description of Cyril,
considered Hypatia's teaching contrary to the Gospels and unleashed against her a horde of ignorant and enraged Christians who didn't even know what she was preaching, but now considered her, with Cyril as witness, dissolute and a liar. Perhaps she was slandered, even if it is also true that women should not meddle in divine questions. In some, they dragged her into a temple, stripped her naked, killed her, massacred her body with the sharp shards of broken vessels, and put her corpse on a pyre. Many legends sprang up about her. They say she was very beautiful, but had taken a vow of virginity. One young man, her disciple, fell madly in love with her, and she showed him a cloth with the blood of her menses, telling him that this only was the object of his desire, not beauty itself. In reality, what she taught no one has ever known exactly. All her writings were lost. Those who had preserved her spoken thought had been killed or had tried to forget what they had heard. Everything we know of her has been handed down to us by the Holy Fathers, who condemned her, and honestly, as writer of histories and chronicles, and I should say an inveterate liar, I tend not to give too much credence to words that an enemy puts into the mouth of an enemy. It's a pretty good description of what we know about Hypatia. So let's start with what we do actually historically know about Hypatia of Alexandria. She was the daughter of Theon. And it was unusual at this time to have the occupation of a philosopher and a mathematician for a woman. So this is striking in and of itself. Every indication is that Theon raised her as one would a son at this time. So she was educated, she was trained up in all the various classical arts she was familiar with, and read all the classical literature. Despite this, despite the fact that she was a woman and very much a man's world, she seems to have been very well regarded by Christians, pagans, and Jews in Alexandria at the time. The story of her celibacy, or her virginity, her vow of virginity, seems to have some basis in reality. She does not appear to have had any sexual relationships. She does not have any progeny, anything like that. She was thought to be quite beautiful, and there are several mentions of her beauty, though at the time of her death, she probably would have been around 65, so not the beautiful young maiden that Romanticism would have us believe. Barolino recounts the story of the suitor who pursues Hypatia and is rebuffed with her menstrual rags. In fact, the Suda, which is a huge, if you're not familiar with this, it's this huge 10th century Byzantine encyclopedia of the ancient Mediterranean world. It had been attributed to an author named Suidas, but we're not quite sure who the author was. This story in the Suda is often repeated as a kind of representation of both her attitudes towards sexuality and her own sort of personal integrity. The Suda states, she remained a virgin and she rejected the suitor with her menstrual rites, saying that they just demonstrated that there is nothing beautiful about carnal desire. And the Suda is, of course, a Christian work. So we have the strange example of a Christian work using Hypatia as a symbol of virtue. But what's striking about this story is this is not the kind of Christian sort of prudery regarding sexuality. It wasn't a despite of sexuality that disempowered women or saw women as the source of some sort of deceptive or even satanic kind of lie. But instead is a statement about the role of materiality vis-a-vis the life of the mind, vis-a-vis the life of the spirit. That those who are bound to carnal desire are not worthy to stand in the presence of the All. And this, I think, has specifically Gnostic overtones. Of course, there's a lot of debate, particularly within the AJC, about the status of materiality within Gnosticism. There are people in the AJC who range from our classic punk rock world-hating dualists, thank you, Father Trent, to those who really embrace materiality as an expression of the emanation of God. So there's no necessary connection between anti-materialism and Gnosticism, as is so often thought. That said, I think that there is a current that recognizes that attachment to the material can be a barrier to spiritual attainment, that it can be a distraction from our spiritual world, and that it represents a kind of stumbling block on our way to reintegration. And I think that this, more than anything else, is what is encapsulated in this story of Hypatia saying to her suitor, what you desire is not what is truly beautiful. What you desire is not what you ought to be desiring. What you desire is the body. And you know what the body is? It's ugly, it's messy, it smells bad, it's inconvenient, it's painful. I mean, let's face it, bodies are horribly, horribly designed. I mean, they're filled with design flaws, right? I mean, clearly we're in the beta test phase of human models. And so the emphasis on the body is what the suitor is being reproached for. That he's missing the point of real beauty. And that, of course, is very much in keeping with Neoplatonist teaching that we see from people like Plotinus and Iamblichus, that there is this strong division, what people like Heidegger are ultimately going to categorize or characterize as ontotheology. This idea of a rigid separation between the world of reason, the world of the ideas or forms, and the material world, which is always nothing more than a pale echo of that divine source. So it's not surprising at all that we would see this kind of thought associated with someone like Hypatia, who was the head of this Platonic school. And we do know that she succeeded her father as the head of the academic school in Alexandria. Most likely, her ideas would have been shaped by those of, as we said, Plotinus Neamblichus. And unfortunately, we don't have our dear friend and contributor, Dr. Jeffrey Kupperman, to say more about Plotinus Neamblichus. He is a specialist in this. But of course, we can see this strong anti-materialist view. One of the most important aspects in Neoplatonist thought is the idea of the ultimate origin of all things in the one, in the unique, in the singular. And if we look at various forms of Gnostic cosmology, we can see really similar sorts of claims. Whether it's the bythos, right, the profundity or the depth, the unnamed God, that source of all things. And this is something I think that Gnosticism inherits from its Platonic and Neoplatonic contribution. Of course, I've mentioned a couple of times over the course of this conclave, the wonderful fact that in the Nag Hammadi library there is a short passage that was given a name because nobody quite knew what to do with it, and it was a little while before anybody figured out that in fact it was a passage from Republic. That the works of Plato were considered by at least some of these early Gnostics as equivalent to scripture. So, on that level, it makes sense that somebody like Hypatia would become a venerated figure for us in the AJC. What else do we know? We also know that she was a mathematician. In fact, her written works seem to focus almost exclusively on mathematics. Although she doesn't appear to have written any mathematical treatises in her own right, but she did assist her father, Theon of Alexandria, in writing his 11-part commentary on Ptolemy's Almagest. She assisted her father in producing a new version, which is, for all intents and purposes, the sort of standard version of Euclid's Elements. She wrote commentaries on Diophantus's Arithmetica, on Apollonius's Conics, and on Ptolemy's astronomical works. So despite the fact that she's not doing sort of original mathematical research on her own, she is nonetheless profoundly contributing to the understanding of the mathematical sciences of the day. She was well known for her virtue, not just in the sense that she was chaste, virginal, but also she was well known for her profound generosity, which seemed to extend to pagans, Christians, and Jews in Alexandria. It was not restricted to any one group. And what we do know is that she was murdered by a mob of Christians. It's simply a fact. In fact, the description that we get from Socrates Scholasticus, whom we mentioned a bit ago, is, I think, very, very telling in its honesty. Socrates writes, "She fell victim to the political jealousy which at that time prevailed. For as she had frequent interviews with Orestes," Orestes was probably pagan, although he may have converted to Christianity at some point, "the governor of Egypt, It was reported among the Christian populace that it was she who prevented Orestes from being reconciled to the bishop here being Cyril. So the problem seems to have been the competition between Orestes and Cyril of Alexandria. Some of them, therefore, hurried away by a fierce and bigoted zeal, whose ringleader was a reader named Peter, waylaid her returning home and dragging her from her carriage, took her to a church called Caesareum, where they completely stripped her, murdered her with tiles. Right? Sometimes we're told it's shells, right? Something very, very sharp and sort of ready to hand. After tearing her body in pieces, they took her mangled limbs to a place called Cinarum, and there burnt them. So even authors who are, Christian authors who are, at least to some extent, sympathetic to Cyril of Alexandria, hold up the actions of the mob as specifically anti-Christian. It's possible that her death came at the hands of the Parabolani. The Parabolani began as a sort of charitable organization feeding the poor in Alexandria, but they became increasingly involved in the Christian pagan riots in Alexandria. The status of paganism in Alexandria at the time is very, very contested. It sits to a certain extent on the cultural outskirts of the empire. And so, despite the fact that Theodosius is currently emperor, he is himself a devout Christian. This Christianity hasn't necessarily filtered through the whole empire in a totalizing sort of way. So there is still a significant pagan power base. So there are these struggles between Christians and pagans in Alexandria. The Parabolani are primarily drawn from the lower classes. And so what we are seeing here to a certain extent is an anti-intellectual revolt against somebody who is seen as an elitist intellectual egghead who challenges a lot of the sort of structures and mores of the day. And so it makes perfect sense that Hypatia should become a target for their rage. There is an account of her death in John of McHugh's Chronicles. And I'm going to ignore it, because it is very, very clearly an attempt to rewrite history in such a way as to vindicate Cyril of Alexandria. It casts her as almost a kind of witch who was using sorcery to beguile the Christians of Alexandria. John clearly takes Socrates Scholasticus' account and twists it to his own purposes. So such an account does exist, but I think it's very, very clearly a bit of propaganda more than anything else. Whereas Socrates Scholasticus impresses me because he is specifically a Christian writer looking at a pagan figure murdered by enraged Christians and says, yeah, guys, we got this one wrong. We made a mistake. And so I think that there's a lot to credit Socrates. What I think is also very, very important to consider in talking about Hypatia of Alexandria is what we get wrong. And there are lots of stories that are told about Hypatia that just don't really add up. One is that she was the keeper of the library of Alexandria, and in the wake of her death, the library was burned by enraged Christians, and all of the collected wisdom of the pagan world was lost in a single moment. This is, what's the word I'm looking for? Complete bullshit. It's nonsense. Number one, it's doubtful that such a structure ever existed. Right? The mythology of the Library of Alexandria containing hundreds of thousands of scrolls of wisdom going all the way back to the pre-Socratic philosophers is probably an invention of Gibbon. It probably doesn't date back any further than 150 years. It was, even if such a library existed, a more modest library, and that seems likely, it was not destroyed by Christians in the 5th century. In fact, Strabo, in 23, already describes it as something ancient, something past, something that's already beginning to enter into legendary status. Now, why do we hear this story of Hypatia as the keeper of the Library of Alexandria? I think there are two reasons. Number one, it's very, very likely that she was the overseer of a daughter library, that there was a repository of wisdom in Alexandria that was associated with the Platonic school, and as the head of the Platonic school, part of her job would have been to preserve that. And that may have, in the pagan Christian riots, been substantially damaged or even destroyed. That's a legitimate historical possibility. But also because I think that there's a mythology here that makes a certain amount of sense. That the library of Alexandria that's being destroyed here isn't some physical place. It's simply Hypatia herself. Right? She's the Library of Alexandria. She's the repository of this wisdom that has come down to us through Plato and Plotinus and Porphyry, Iamblichus and Theon and all of these other great Neoplatonist thinkers. So, not historically true, but still, this is an important sort of moment. She was not killed by enraged Christians because she was a woman. Let's just go ahead and put that one, to the side, right? Being a woman didn't seem to be an obstacle for her, that she seemed to very much rise above the patriarchalism of the day. And she was widely regarded by Christian authorities and seen very much as an equal. That said, there does seem to be a certain sort of reaction against a woman speaking in the places of men, as it were, among the sort of lower class Christians, people like the Barbalani, who would not have been part of the intellectual elite that was much more accepting of somebody like Hypatia. She was not killed because she was a pagan. There were lots and lots of pagans, right? Orestes, most likely, was a pagan. So being a pagan was itself not sufficient to account for her death at the hands of this Christian mob. That said, it's likely that she served as a kind of focus for anti-pagan hatred and violence, and that she would have proved a convenient target for their violence. It would have been really problematic for this mob of Christians to go after Orestes, being the governor, right? It's a lot easier to go after Hypatia. So there may be that move there. She was not killed by these Christians because she was a philosopher, or because she was a mathematician, or a proto-scientist. I don't think that the kind of mob action sort of ascends to that kind of critical concern. But we have to concede that early Christianity was, in many ways, misogynistic and clearly anti-pagan. And as a consequence of the relationship between the philosophical, mathematical, and scientific inquiry of the day and paganism, it was anti-intellectual. There is this very, very strong anti-intellectualism. And I think more than anything else, it is this that fuels the fire of the mob that ultimately kills Hypatia. We should not think that Hypatia was anti-Christian. It's likely that there were a lot of Christians who were anti-Hypatia. But she was not herself a crusader against Christianity. She was not a pagan true believer who was trying to defeat Christianity. She was not an enemy of Cyril of Alexandria because Cyril was Christian. We know that Synesius of Cyrene, who was later to become the bishop of Ptolemais, is a student of hers. And even after he becomes bishop of Ptolemais, he continues to write to her and continues clearly to hold her in profound esteem. Synesius, by the way, was one of the early exponents of what we sort of identify now as strong Trinitarianism. And so she isn't somebody who's trying to actively undermine the Christian authority of the day, and certainly is not theologically anti-Christian. She is a pagan. Make no mistake about that. And she does have run-ins with Cyril. As I said, Hypatia was close to the Roman governor Orestes, and Cyril and Orestes were pretty intent on pissing in each other's weeds. But Hypatia seems to have simply gotten caught up in some of the politics of the day. There was a strongly anti-Christian letter that was supposedly written by her that was circulated soon after her death, but this is widely known to be forgery. So this was just part of the propaganda. Some other mistakes that we make about her. Often it's said that she was the inventor of the astrolabe or of the hydrometer, neither of which is true. Synesius, her student who becomes Bishop Ptolemais, writes to her to ask her advice on constructing an astrolabe and a hydrometer. But these machines had already existed. Her father, actually, Theon, writes fairly extensive commentary on the construction of an astrolabe and use of hydrometer, which is used to measure the specific gravity of liquids, is fairly well attested at this time. That's not meant to take away from her very real accomplishments, achievements, and insights in mathematics, but a lot of what we know about, or what we think we know about Hypatia, is merely 19th century romanticism that has sort of blown her into this image of the sort of last surviving vestige of the classical world fighting the good fight against an anti-intellectual Christianism that is going to put women under the boot of patriarchalism. And as much as we might like to buy into that, and it is very appealing in many ways to see Hypatia in that way, I think we do her a disservice in doing so. I think we sell short what she really accomplished and what she really represented. So we have this image of a woman who stands out as an exceptional intellect, a woman of exceptional character, of profound integrity, of great wisdom, of learning, who's able to make a place for herself in the Roman Empire. And that's, in and of itself, extraordinary and worth valorizing. But why is she important for us? Why is she important for the AJC? We're not pagans fighting the good fight against patriarchal Christians. Exactly.
7 days.
Some days. We're not sort of fighting the good fight to prevent women from being put under the boot of patriarchy, except we totally are. So wait a second, so maybe this story tells us more about ourselves than it does about Hypatia. The fact that we hold Hypatia up as a saint tells us what we value. It tells us what's important to us. Intellect, thoughtfulness, criticism, a willingness to stand up against even those who would be our erstwhile co-religionists. A willingness to maintain our integrity in the face of difficulty. But to turn back to the characterization that we see in Umberto Eco, I think we get a wonderful, and I think very plausible and thoughtful, as I said, description of what she might well have taught. And I think that, of course, Eco does a wonderful job of putting this into beautiful language. There's a particular passage where the Hypatia talks to Baudolino about the nature of God. It's a long passage, but bear with me, I think it's worth it. God, she said, is the unique. And he is so perfect that he does not resemble any of the things that exist or any of the things that do not. You cannot describe him using human intelligence. As if you were someone who became angry if you're bad or who worries about you out of goodness. Someone who has a mouth, ears, face, wings, or that is spirit, father, or son, not even of himself. Of the unique, you cannot say that he is or is not, for he embraces all but is nothing. You can name him only through dissimilarity, because it is futile to call him, and this is interesting, the list of qualities here. Goodness, beauty, wisdom, amiability, power, justice. To me, that sounds a lot like a lot of the names of the aliens. It would be like calling him bear, panther, serpent, dragon, or griffin. Because whatever you say of him, you will never express him. So there is a kind of via negativa. There is a kind of apophantic theology at play here. Now, do we want to necessarily attribute that kind of apophantic theology to the historical Hypatia? That may be going too far. But I think that Eco is well justified in thinking this. Later on in the same passage, she gives what is, for my money, one of the most beautiful expressions of the nature of God. Try to understand, Baudolino, she says. God is a lamp without flame, a flame without fire, a fire without heat, a dark light, a silent rumble, a blind flash, a luminous soot, a ray of his own darkness, a circle that expands, concentrating on its own center, a solitary multiplicity. He is, she paused, seeking an example that would convince them both. She the teacher and he the pupil. He is a space that is not, in which you and I are the same thing, as we are today in this time that doesn't flow. That's extraordinary. To my mind, and this calls up the descriptions in The Thunder Perfect Mind, for example, where we're given these sets of contradictions. And it's wonderful that Eco has the wisdom to put these words into the mouth of Hypatia. from a strictly Gnostic standpoint, she does tell the story of the Demiurge. She says, the unique constantly tries to reabsorb this sort of breath that can become poison. For 70 times 7,000 years, he has succeeded continually to make his residue return into nothingness. The life of God was a regulated breathing. He panted without effort, like this. Listen. She breathed in the air, vibrating her delicate nostrils, and exhaled the breath for a moment. One day, however, he was unable to control one of his intermediary powers, which we call the Demiurge, and which is perhaps Sabaoth or Yaldabaoth, the false god of the Christians. This imitation of God, through a mistake or through pride or through ignorance, created time, where before there had been only eternity. Time is an eternity that stammers. I love that. So, Eco, at least, really sees a kind of Gnostic Hypatia. I think that is perhaps wishing too much from an historical standpoint. I don't believe that Hypatia necessarily would have been associated with what we would identify as historical Gnosticism, because there is a well-known sort of breach between Neoplatonism and practical Gnosticism. But nonetheless, the linkages seem to be there. So what is it, perhaps more importantly than who Hypatia is, that she represents? It's important that Hypatia is a woman. Let us not lose sight of that. That is vitally, vitally important. She is a person who is subject in a way that I think that even today we could have difficulty trying to imagine. And yet, she is able to, by sheer force of intellect, it seems, stand toe-to-toe with the great men of her age. She is a victim of injustice. She is a victim of the cultural and religious divisions that tore apart Alexandria. And those divisions come to be represented in her. She is a philosopher, a mathematician, a scientist, to use a somewhat anachronistic term. She is somebody for whom the life of the mind was of paramount importance. And she seems, more than anything else, to have lived her philosophy in a profound way. And if you'll allow me one more time to return to Umberto Eco, he describes a practice. He describes something that she does that, again, I find incredibly striking. A practice that she calls, perhaps not surprisingly, asthesis. The point is only the beginning. We learn to become messengers between what is above and what is below. We prove that the current in which God emanates himself can be retraced, only for a short way. But we show nature that this is possible. The supreme task, however, is not to connect the sunflower to the sun. It is to connect ourselves with our origin. This is where asthesis begins. In the beginning, we learn to live in a virtuous manner. We do not kill living creatures. We try to spread harmony among the beings that are around us. And in doing this, we can revive hidden sparks everywhere. You see these blades of grass, they are yellow and are drooping to the ground. And you can touch them, make them vibrate again, make them feel what they have forgotten. Look, little by little, they regain their freshness as if they were just now springing from the earth. Yet this is not enough. To revive this blade of grass, it suffices to exercise the natural virtues, achieve perfection of sight and hearing, vigor of body, memory and facility for learning, refinement of manners through frequent ablutions, lustful ceremonies, hymns, prayers. You make a step forward by cultivating wisdom, strength, temperance, and justice, and finally you arrive at acquiring the purifying virtues. We try to separate the soul from the body. We learn to evoke the gods, not to speak of the gods, as the other philosophers did, but to act upon them, causing rains to fall through a magic sphere, setting amulets against earthquakes, testing the divinatory powers of tripods, animating statues to attain oracles, summoning Asclepius to heal the sick. But you have to be careful. In doing this, we always avoid being possessed by a god, because in that case we become unruly and agitated, and therefore move away from them. We must learn to do this in the most absolute calm. And I think that this practice, this practical dimension, is part of what Hypatia represents for us. And let us not mince words too much. She represents, I think, for us, the struggle between Johannite or Johannine Christianity and Petrine Christianity. Not the anti-intellectual Christianity that is all too familiar, I think, to most of us, and which has such a strong historical component. There was, of course, a time in which everything that was written prior to the Christ event was simply considered to be pagan learning and therefore without value. And we do know that there have been reactions by Christians against the intellect. But Johannine Christianity defies this. It is not anti-intellectual, but instead informed by a variety of philosophical sources. It is not anti-pagan, but rather sees itself as part of a continuous and unfolding revelation of the divine in the world. The revelation of the divine in history. And the pagan thinkers and creators, mystics and magicians, are as much a part of that tradition as the Christian saints. It is not misogynistic, but embracing of the presence of the sacred flame in all people. In our liturgy, we talk about the oath taken by the Templars between the hands of Theoclete, representative of the Constantinopolitan see, a see always hostile to that of Rome since the time of Phocas. And as much as we borrow from the mainstream tradition of Christianity, the Petrine tradition of Christianity, and as much as we can see the seeds of Gnosis tended to within the great churches of Rome and Constantinople and Alexandria and elsewhere, what we do has to take on its own significance, has to take on its own identity, has to be true to the tradition that precedes it. And I think Hypatia can be an image of our own ideal. There is little, unfortunately, that we know about Hypatia of Alexandria. Much that we have told and much that we know is simply wrong. But as a myth, as a figure, I think that she represents what is most extraordinary in our tradition today. I think that she represents some of the greatest aspects of what the Joanite Church has to offer. And I think that her age is not so dissimilar from our age. And so I think that what she lived and taught represents vitally, vitally important for us today. Thank you very much. I'd be happy to entertain any questions, though I will admit right off the bat, I'm not a specialist in Hypatia, or you know, I don't know if one can be a specialist in Hypatia, but if you have any questions, I'm certainly happy to entertain them.
What and how does she become a saint of the church?
That's an excellent question for which I do not have a good answer.
Was the question when?
Yeah, when and how, I think, is...
1975, probably.
I mean, I think it's just sort of inherited in many ways.
No, I think it comes from my time.
Does it?
It's not an EGP. It's not a... I don't think it's an EGP thing, and I don't think it's from my
time. I don't think it's German either.
I think it comes from my time, and I don't know when we were fleshing out the calendar, if just everybody tossed their favorite names and then... I can't actually remember. There's lots where I can remember by saying, okay, you know, we need these.
As is so often the case in the sort of formative periods of these organizations, a lot just simply gets lost. I mean, look at all of the saints of the Christian Church that nobody can sort of tack down exactly why is this person a saint? Where did they come from? Who the hell are they?
It could be lost in the mists of the early noughties.
Right, exactly.
Some time ago.
So I don't have a good answer. I think that's as good an answer as we're going to have.
I really appreciate you bringing to us the sources that are available, including a modern one. And I really just want to ask, what did you think of the movie?
I haven't seen it.
Which one are you talking about?
I grew up. I haven't seen it.
I really enjoyed it. It does end with the burning in the library. No, sorry, it's quite
a lot of criticisms have been lodged against it because of its historical inaccuracies.
But you know, you gotta make it up.
Wizard
of history, you gotta make it up.
When you're telling the story,
she invents heliocentric astronomy.
No.
She doesn't get to tell anybody, and then she's killed, so nobody ever finds out.
No. I haven't seen it. I actually consider like sort of arranging for sort of a viewing of it, but it just sort of never came together. So
I've heard of Hypatia being conflated with Catherine of Alexandria. Do you know anything about that?
I've never heard that, no. I would have to look at sort of how that's being used, because I would imagine such a conflation has an agenda, right? I would imagine that there's a specific reason that we would want to put these together. We do have, I think, enough historical sort of testimony about her to confirm her independent existence. I would have to look at that. That's an interesting point. Maybe we can talk more about that later.
There's a novel about Hypatia called Flow Down Like Silver, and it's by K. Longfellow. The first name is spelled K-I.
Yes.
Longfellow, she's a British writer. She's written like some murder mysteries, but she's written this quote-unquote Gnostic series. So the first book is called The Secret Magdalene, about Mary Magdalene and some guy named Yeshua.
I think I've heard of him.
And John the Baptist is in there, and this character who ends up being, we don't know until almost the very end, and he's Simon Magus. Those are two really, really great books, and then Parabolani, that Longfellow, she has them as central characters, as sort of a group in Flow Down Like Silver about Hypatia.
Yeah.
And they're kind of pictured in her hands as Anthony.
think that, that's not inaccurate. Yeah. I think that that's probably historically pretty accurate.
Yeah, and Longfellow portrays Hypatia as kind of what you're sort of getting at, which was not Gnostic per se, but was so conversant with the cultural and intellectual milieu of Alexandria for time that she was in communication with people we would call quote-unquote Gnostic and had some sympathy for Gnostics and Gnosticism, but yes, was kind of from a pagan background and still definitely had a foot in paganism.
Mm-hmm.
So I really recommend those two books, Secret Franklin and Pull Down My Silver. And rumor has it, or I read it somewhere, that this is like a trilogy, and that book three of the Gnostic series by Longfellow will be about Hildegard of Bingen,
mm-hmm.
who is another figure who's adjacent to Saint.
Yeah, okay.
But also, like Hypatia, wasn't exactly Gnostic, and in Hildegard's case, she was probably less sympathetic than Hypatia because,
mm-hmm.
you know, Hildegard got up in front of cathedrals and preached holy hell against the Cathars.
Yeah.
So she's kind of Hildegard's kind of difficult figure who, in a lot of ways, we as Gnostics, modern Gnostics, admire her because the way she talked about the feminine, the way she talked about creation, you know, a whole lot of things. And just that she was a woman who was like, you know, as Barbara Newman calls her, a sister of wisdom, who was about as feminist as you could be in the 12th century.
She was convinced.
Yeah.
Yeah, Dr. Eimer's talk at Last Conclave on Hildegard. Right, really, I mean, in many ways, there are these neat sort of parallels. So it makes sense that should be the third one. So if you haven't, you know, for all of you, if you haven't listened to, I mean, we've got the recording.
Yeah.
Is it out? Is up there? If you haven't listened to that lecture by Dr. Eimer on Hildegard, I really, really strongly recommend it. So, because it deals exactly with what you're identifying.
I was just going to mention that we do have some figures that, we revere them and we respect them for their contribution. At the same time, we recognize that, you know, certain things are narrow. We don't have to embrace everything like that.
Mm-hmm.
Hildegard, wasn't a fan of gay folks. I think it was at least one. Yeah, I mean,
I'm extensively.
Yeah.
Yeah.
As a guitar player, I'm a fan of you too, but I think Mona's kind of dead. So, you can.
It's not a package deal.
That's right.
Yeah, and these are. I mean, look at our scriptures, right? I mean, there are things in our scriptures where I just go, no, wrong, bad song, right? So.
Yeah.
The woman who's writing is sort of an apologist for Cyril of Alexandria for his part in the Raleigh.
Oh, John McHugh.
I may have got a hold of that someone because in reading up on that piece yet, I got a hold of some information. Maybe it's been on Wikipedia talking about how the bishop had condemned the actions of them and he had not told them to go do that. And I don't know if that's the apologistic version of the story or if that's sort of a more modern version.
Now, I think that may well be John's Chronicles. That sounds like something that's coming from there.
You didn't really go into it in detail. Could you kind of give just a brief example of what Cyril's contribution to the wildness of that mind was?
Yeah, it's unclear. We don't have a sort of solid sense of what Cyril's role in this was. It's possible that he, had an active role in it. It's possible that it might have been the Parabolani. We're not really sure. And I think that the role that Cyril plays in the story tells you pretty much everything you need to know about the agenda of the person who's writing. Right, somebody like John McHugh is going to say, "Oh, poor Cyril. He was absolutely innocent. He had nothing to do with this this thing, and she was an evil sorceress, and blah, 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 right? And then you're going to see on the other side people who want to valorize Hypatia will say, oh, you know, Cyril just, you know, fed the flames, and then it was on his orders that she was kept, right? The truth is probably somewhere in the middle, right? It does seem to, the actions of the mob do seem to grow out of the struggle between Orestes and Cyril. I think it's probably likely, if I'm going to venture a speculation, that they were acting as they thought they were acting on behalf of Cyril, but not under orders from Cyril.
I mean, he sort of, you know, said something like, "Will someone not read me of this terrible story?"
Right, exactly. I don't even think it's probably that direct. I think that they just sort of see they love Cyril, and this woman is poisoning Orestes against Cyril, at least in their view. Therefore, we can't go after Orestes, we're gonna go after her. That seems to be, at least from my perspective, and that's purely speculative, the most plausible answer. So. Mm-hmm.
Do we know if Orestes, in the wake of her murder,
I don't think so. I think he was too busy with his own problems. I know that I think I would have to go back to my material for this, so I might be wrong on this. I think that he tries to argue that he has converted to Christianity and nobody quite believes him. Right? They think he's just sort of faking it. And that's sort of his way of trying to settle the issue, but I don't think it works. And I think he's so caught up in his own issues that she is just collateral damage from his perspective. I don't think Orestes is any kind of hero in this story at all.
Anything else?
Thank you. I'm going to say just one last thing. Beth, I really want to appreciate. I really want to thank. His Eminence and His Excellency and the Apostolic Council for making the effort to rename this lecture series in honor of Dr. Armour. I think it is an extraordinary gift and very much speaks to the contributions that she made to the church. I think it is the most fitting tribute that you could have made. So thank you.